Okay, so this is lecture 29. Okay, and we're going to start a new topic today. So it's going to be convolutional codes. Okay, so convolutional codes. It's going to be the topic. So relative to what we've been studying so far, so if you look at if you look at the codes that we saw so far, classical codes, one can say Reed-Solomon codes was the most important code we saw, and then we saw LDPC codes. The way it worked out was, for Reed-Solomon codes, you could prove very strong distance properties. You could show that it was MDS and all that, it met the singleton bound. But on the decoding side, the only thing you could do is bounded distance decoding, right? You can't even do ML decoding or anything. If you know that the errors were less than the error correcting capability, one can decode it. That was the Reed-Solomon part. There had a lot of nice construction. Encoding was easy. Decoding was implementable. Was no problem. Okay. So then we moved on to LDPC codes, where the construction was random. It was not deterministic or anything like that. But there was a decoder, which is a message passing decoder, which is reasonable to implement, and it gives you, in fact, capacity achieving approaching performance, right? We saw that at least for the AWGN channel, it gives great performance, but the encoding is a little bit complicated, okay? So the biggest difference there were two differences. One was, the main thing is the decoding, right? The fact that you can do efficient soft decoding, which can give you all this great performance. And then the construction also plays a part in it, but the construction is essentially random, right? So there's not really anything great about the construction. So convolutional codes, in my opinion, fall somewhere in the middle. Okay, so the construction is deterministic. Okay, so deterministic construction. Okay, very, very simple encoders. Okay, some of the simplest encoders out there. Okay, well, next to repetition, right, one can say convolutional codes have some of the simplest encoding algorithms out there. Okay, so in fact, the encoding is simply a shift register. Okay, so binary shift register with very small memory, like 4 or 5 things like that. There's absolutely nothing in that encoding. Okay, and it turns out you can do soft ML decoding efficiently. Okay, so you can implement the best possible decoder, the optimal decoder, which is a soft maximum likelihood decoder, exactly in a very nice implementable way. It's a simple algorithm which will run for you and give you the ML decoding. But since so the performance certainly will be, in many cases it will be, it you'll see it will be slightly better than Reed-Solomon, one might say. But we saw some plots, you remember, right? So when you go to really low rates like 3/4 and all that, both of them are reasonably the same. I don't know if you remember this plot that I showed you some time back. So maybe we'll come back and see that. What is the comparison between convolutional codes and Reed-Solomon codes, for instance? Okay. But since their encoding is deterministic and simple and all that, you won't get capacity achieving performance. Okay. So it won't get you very close to capacity, even though you can do optimal decoding. Okay. So you can see both are important. I mean, you need to have good codes also. Okay, so it's not just enough to be able to optimally decode. Repetition code you can optimally decode, right? But it will not give you any coding gain, right? So the coding gain is obtained by a combination of both. You need a reasonably good code and soft decoding. Okay, so you need both. Okay, and the convolutional codes kind of lose out on one. Okay, they're not great codes, but they have good decoders, and in practice this gives you a good trade-off in many situations. Okay, so you can imagine. So soft ML decoding will definitely be complex, okay, but the encoder is really, really simple. So if you have a situation like deep space communication, where there's a satellite far, far away which is taking all its energy from the sun or something like that, then what do you want that encoder to be? The encoder should be the simplest possible encoding, right? Decoder here on Earth can be as complex as it wants. There's no problem. So in those kind of situations, these codes are really useful. Okay, so there are many other situations like this, even your cell phone for that matter. one can imagine the encoding should be simple because it's running on battery, it's a very small device. Well, today you can put a lot of power in there, but still it's a small device. You probably want the encoding to be very simple, while the base station probably has power from the supply and then it can do a lot of complicated arithmetic and it can have complex decoders. In fact, convolutional codes sit on every one of your cell phones today. Okay, so yeah, so downlink will have to be different. Maybe the same thing can be done, but it's usually different. So see, the uplink is also power constrained. Maybe one can imagine downlink being, but well, that's not the right way of viewing it, but still it's what's done. Okay, so your cell phone will convert your speech into digital thing and then it will encode with a suitable rate convolutional code and send it to the base station. Okay, so you see there's a lot of benefit there. Okay, so this is a philosophy, and beyond this there's really nothing much to teach. Okay, the soft ML decoding, you might have seen some version of it. It's basically Viterbi decoding. So you might have seen some version of it, and the constructions, there is no, see for instance for the Reed-Solomon code, there is a specific construction for the parity check matrix. Here there is no specific construction. People have already done, they'll tell you this is the best construction and you have to just take it. There's no question of understanding it or anything like that. Even for the LDPC codes, we at least had some notion of there is some optimization which exists to find degree distributions. Here there is nothing like that. Okay, so once you do the construction, it's very simple, straightforward. So really there's nothing much. So I won't take more than 2 or 3 lectures of convolutional codes. It's not a big deal. But the slightly non-trivial thing which we have to see is turbo codes. Okay, so very recently people found very smart ways of using convolutional codes as several convolutional codes together and making much better codes out of them. Okay, so you already knew convolutional codes are reasonably efficient decoders. Now when you make better codes out of them, then you can get closer to capacity. So turbo codes can take you very close to capacity, not as close as the LDPC codes, but within 1 dB or so in practice, in with simulations one can check. So it's pretty good. So this is what we'll do, and let's see where we go. Okay, so the best way to describe convolutional codes is start by describing their encoding, and in fact the best way to describe their encoders is to just start giving examples. Okay, so we'll see examples are the only thing. Okay, so the generalization will be very obvious from the example. Anything else I do will also be exactly the same thing. There's nothing much different. Okay, so it's enough if I do examples. So I'll follow that. I'll pretty much do example after example wherever necessary. And the general statements, if you're interested, you can read it from the books. Okay, so there are general statements also, but I will not do too much of them in this class. Okay, so we'll begin by seeing example of a convolutional encoder. Okay, so the encoder I'm going to show you looks like this. I'll simply draw the diagram. It's a finite state machine, so I can draw it with a set of D flip-flops. I'll draw it like that. Okay, so let me write that down. It's a finite state machine. I'll do a D flip-flop implementation. Okay, it's in fact a very simple shift register based finite state machine, so there's nothing much to do here. So in this particular example, we'll have 3 D flip-flops. Okay, and the input connecting here. So I won't show things like clock and all. Okay, so you have to assume that all these things are clocked and synchronous and all that. Okay, so I have 2 outputs. I'll put a XOR gate here. So this is a multi-input XOR gate. This plus with a circle around it. So it's basically modulo 2 addition, right? So I'm going to do that. I will connect it to the different inputs. Okay, so the first guy will connect to this one, and this one. This will be the output. The second guy I'll connect to all 4. Okay, this is your input, this is output 1, this is output 2. Okay, So of course we'll have notation for all these things, but at the end of the day it's very clear what's happening, right? So your input bits are going to be clocked in from the left side of this picture, okay? And as they keep getting clocked in, you will start getting outputs also, right? So it's a very simple encoder. I don't even have to describe what this is, but I will use some notation and give you a description, okay? So the most important thing in a finite state machine is the state itself, right? So what is the state here? How will you describe the state of this finite state machine? Yeah, bits at the output of each of the flip-flops. So I'll call this as S0, S1, S2. Okay, so how many bits do I need to describe the state? 3 bits. So how many possible states can there be? 2 power 3, which is 8 possible states. So it's an 8 state encoder. Okay, so that's the first thing. Okay, so the memory of this encoder is 3, number of states is 8. Okay, so this number 8 is very typical. Okay, so people will always talk about the number of states when they talk about a finite state machine, right? So it's an 8 state encoder. Okay, so that's the way you talk about this. It's an 8 state encoder. Okay, my input comes in here. My input will actually be a sequence, right? I'll imagine my input to be a sequence of bits. Okay, maybe a finite length sequence. In fact, it's not very relevant. You'll see, it just depends on the particular time instant. But I will think of my input as a sequence. Similarly, my output will also be a sequence. Okay, so my input sequence I'll denote as U. Okay. U0, U1, so on. Okay, my first output sequence I'll denote V with a superscript 0. It's going to be V01, V02, so on. My second output sequence I'll denote as V with a superscript 1, which will be V11, V12, so on. Okay, so I'm writing U as U0, U1, so on, but what is the first input that the finite state machine will see? It's U0, okay, so you should remember this thing is coming in the reverse direction, okay, but we are used to writing the vectors as U0, U1, but don't think of that as U1 coming before U0, U0 will come first, okay, so the next time instant you'll get U1, the next time instant you'll get U2, likewise, okay, that's how it's clocked in, okay, so it's kind of inverse in that fashion. Okay, so maybe I should do 0 here. I'm sorry, I should do 0 here. I should not do 1. Apologize for this. It's good to start with the 0, 1. So, 0, 1. Okay, this is my. Is that clear? Okay, so what will S0 be? Okay, so at the nth time instant, how will the entire picture look? Okay, what is the input bit? UN. What is S0? UN-1. Okay, what is S1? UN-2. What is S2? UN-3. Okay, so the state is in fact, right, since I'm just doing shifting, the 3 previous bits that went through my, that were input. Okay, UN-1, N-2, and N-3. Okay, and UN is the current input. Okay, so in current input bit is UN, S0 is UN-1, S1 is UN-2, and S2 is UN-3. So you see why I say the system has memory 3, right? So it remembers the 3 previous inputs and uses it in computing the output. What is the output now? What is V0N? It will be UN plus S1 plus S2, but I already know S1 and S2 in terms of UN-2, so I can write the whole thing in terms of U itself. Okay, it's going to be UN plus UN-2 plus UN-3. What is this plus now? This plus is modulo 2 addition. Okay, so it's XOR. So likewise I can also write V1N as UN plus UN-1 plus UN-2 plus UN-3. Okay, so I mean different people have different ways of different, they like different things. For instance, some people might say, all you need is the last two expressions. I don't care about all this picture. What is this picture? It's just a waste of ink, right? Just representing at the end of the day, just this, these two equations. But some people don't like just those equations. They like this picture better. Okay, so we have the whole thing in front of you. Okay, so it's just, you can either think of it as a picture and bits moving in and out, clocked in and out, or just this equation. Just implement this equation. In software, you might want to just implement this equation as opposed to thinking of some picture like this. Okay, so standard finite state machine is really, really simple. There's nothing much to say. Okay, the encoder cannot get any simpler than this. Okay, it's one of the simplest encoders out there. Okay, the current bit, yeah, we think of that as the input also. State is only previous whatever happened. So at time n, the system is at state S0, S1, S2. You should not include the input for the state. It's already in that state by the time it comes to time. So it's got to do with negative edge, positive edge. I don't know enough about these things. But anyway, that's how you think about it. Okay, whatever happens before that is the state. Okay, all right. So there's one more way in which you can view this. Okay, just like we viewed it in so many different ways. To write down the way. So one might want to write this expression in so many different ways. This is a difference equation, right? Maybe we are not very happy with difference equations, right? So you see, for instance, when you do filters, right, digital filters in DSP, at the end of the day, it's all difference equation when you do finite impulse response filters. But you're not ever happy with just the difference equation. You want something called a impulse response. You want to figure out what happens when the response is an impulse. Okay, and then what is the, so that impulse response can then be converted into frequency domain, and you want to view it in so many different ways. Okay, so maybe we'll do that also with this thing, right? At the end of the day, it's just a difference equation. Of course, the difference is you're doing modulo 2, right? You're not doing, usually in filters you don't do modulo 2. Here you're doing modulo 2, but still it's only a difference equation. So one can even think of this as being a linear system and worry about what its impulse response will be. It's got one input and two outputs. So suppose my impulse is an input. What is impulse now? 1 followed by a whole bunch of zeros. What will be the two outputs? That will be the impulse response of my encoder. Okay, so I'm going to write that next. So I'll call I'll denote the first impulse response as G0 and the second impulse response as G1. Okay, so as you very well know, in a linear system, once you give the impulse response, using that one can describe the response to any other input. How will you do that? Yeah, you convolve with the impulse response, right? So all that we'll see. I mean, you see all those things have very simple extensions. Okay, so what will G0 be in this example? If I put 1 followed by a whole bunch of zeros as the input, what will G0 be? You can go back and look at the picture if you want. It will be?
What is the initial state of the system?
Initial state is assumed to be 0. 1011, that will be G0, right? The impulse response you see at output 1 will be 1011. After that, what? It's all 0. So one can stop there. Okay, you can say the impulse response is 1011. What about for G1? 1111. Very simple. Okay, it just depends on the connections. Okay, so it's going to be 1011. I'll just stop here. I know it's going to stop here. G1 will be 1111. In fact, you know, you might be familiar with your, if you're very comfortable with these difference equations and viewing them as IIR and FIR, unless you have feedback, you will never have an infinite impulse response for a input. Okay, so here you don't have any feedback. See, right? The way I wrote it down was just simple feed forward structure. So I'll definitely have a finite impulse response. In fact, I can even say the length of my finite impulse response will be equal to 3 plus 1. It will be 4. It will never be greater than 4. Right? So one can define new quantities for that if you want. Okay. So it's also common to just give these two things. Right? If I just give G0 and G1, I've completely defined everything I want. I can go back from here to even that picture very easily. Right? You see, these ones are basically the connections. And the length minus 1 is your memory. Okay, assuming, well, of course, if it goes to infinite length, then there is some trouble. But for finite responses with feed forward structures alone, this is enough. Okay, so all these things are standard system stuff that you might have learned in so many ways. So it's very easy to do. Okay, so the next step is to say, once I have the impulse response, V0 can be written as U convolved with G0, and V1 can be written as U convolved with G1. So this is convolution modulo 2. Okay, so you do the same convolution, you do the flip and the slip, and you do modulo 2, you will get all your. Okay, in fact, you can recover the difference equation from this. It's very easy to see, like un plus un minus 2 plus un minus 3 will be the first one. It's all very easy. It's the same thing, put in different language. Okay, so the next step comes when you're tired of doing convolution, flipping and slipping and all that, you want to think of transforms, right? So the transform that's very useful in DSP is what? The Z transform, right? So the Z transform is for real numbers. So instead of Z now, we'll do D transform, because we're doing everything modulo 2. So we'll do D transform. Okay, so what is D transform of a sequence? Okay, so I have to define that. Okay, so if I have a sequence, I'll define it for a general sequence. If I have a sequence x equals x0, x1, x2, so on. Remember, I only care about causal, right? So I don't worry about the negative thing and all. I will only write for causal sequences. I'll say my D transform x of D is what? It's just motivated by the Z transform. Okay, so you do x0 plus x1. We won't do D inverse and all that. Okay, so we'll just say D x2 D squared, so on. That's my D transform. Okay. So the advantage with D transform now is, instead of convolution, you'll get what? Multiplication. Okay, so polynomial multiplication is the same as convolution. Okay, so you write it differently, you get the same thing. Okay, so once I go to D transform domain, I can make everything in, write down everything in D transform. So for instance, what will be G0D? 1 plus D square plus D power 3. What is G1D? 1 plus D plus D squared plus D power 3. Okay, and then what will V0D be? Will be U of D times G0D. So the same proof for why convolution becomes polynomial multiplication in Z transform will carry over here with D transform, except that you'll do everything modulo 2 now. Okay, so that's one more thing that's important. This polynomial multiplication, everything will be modulo 2. Likewise, V1 of D will be U of D G1 D. So this is particularly useful. Suppose I give you an input sequence, it's easy to convert it into a polynomial and then do polynomial multiplication, as opposed to let it go through the finite state machine one by one and be careful about which is one, which is zero, which is your state, which is not your state. You don't have to worry about all that. Convert the input into a D transform, then you know your G1 of D, G0 of D, multiply, you'll get V0 of D, V1 of D. And then what you should do? From V0 of D and V1 of D, how will you get back to the actual output? Yeah, so you take the coefficients of the D transform. Okay, but then you have to do a series to parallel type conversion, because at time 1, both outputs are occurring like that. Okay, so how do you translate that is important. Okay, I didn't talk about it, I'll come back. Okay, so
here we get only rates 1 by n.
Yeah, I'm coming to it. Okay. So another thing to keep in mind is, finally when it goes into the channel, the bits can go only one at a time, right? So you have to convert them into one at a time. So what people do usually is, the final output V will be V0, 0, V0, 1, V1, 0, V1, 1, so on. Okay, this will be your final output. Okay, this is the output. Okay, I know I didn't write it down carefully, I should have paid attention to it. So you take the outputs at both the time and then you multiplex them one after the other into the channel. Okay, so that's what you do. So here again, when you compute this, you'll have to change it. So let's do a simple example just to get started. Suppose you say U is 11011. Okay, I want you to give me V. So what's B? Okay, maybe we'll do V0 first. What is V0?
1111010101.
This is V0. Okay, what is V1? I'm sorry? What is V1? 1001 1001. Okay. So first thing you'll notice is the length of U and the length of V0 are different. Why does that happen? There's two more, or how many more? Three more. Yeah, the state has to clear out. No, so you'll have to wait till the state becomes zero. Okay, so you'll see that length extra three will be there. Okay, so right. So that's something you have to accept. Okay, so it will come out and you have to take that out. So that's the first thing. Okay, so if this has got length 5, the length here will be 5 plus 3. Okay, where does this 3 come from? This is memory. Okay, here it might seem simple. Okay, but if my last bit had been 0 in U, you might say you don't, this last would not have been 1. Okay, so but even then you have to insist on taking that extra 0. Okay, so this plus plus 3 will always come in V0 and V1. You have to clear out the state. Okay, so there's some importance there, we'll see later on, that's important. Okay, and what will V be? 1 1 1 0 1 0 1 1 0 1 1 0 0 0 1 1. Okay, so for instance, if I ask a question, what is the rate of this code if I send 5 bit? So if I set my message length to 5, I'll have 2 power 5 30, which is 32 different messages. How many code words will I have? Of course, I'll have 32 code words corresponding to each of those messages. What will be the length of each code word? 16. Right? So what's the rate? 5 by 16. Okay. If I set my message length as 6, what will be the rate? 6 by 18. Okay. So in general, if my message length is k, what will be the rate? K by 2k plus 6, right? In this case, right? Okay, so as k becomes really really large, what will this tend to? Tends to half for large k. So the extra 6 is because of clearing the state. Okay, so if you don't insist on that, you can do that, but you'll see later on that's important. You have to clear the state. Okay, for your ML decoder to work well, you need to clear the state. Okay, so that will work out. So for finite length, it will be different. Okay. Alright, so even though I described it as a finite state machine and all that, one can write down very easily the list of all messages and list of all code words. One can do that. Okay, so you will have 2 power k here and you will have 2 power k code words of length. Length what? Length 2k plus 6. In fact, overall it will be a 2k plus 6 comma k linear code. In fact, linear block code. Once I fix a particular block message length, if I say my message length stops here, it becomes a 2k plus 6 comma k linear block code. Why am I saying it's linear? If I add any two outputs, will I get another output in the same list? You have to, right? See, it's entirely a linear system. I can describe my entire operation as a polynomial multiplication. U of d times g of d. If I multiply u1 of d, u2 of d, oh yeah, when I add it, I will get definitely another message which corresponds to this. So it's, in fact, it's a block code in disguise when you fix k as a constant. Okay, but usually it helps to think of this as a sequence. Okay, without fixing k as a constant. K can be any large number that you want. Okay, it helps to, I mean, in every most practical implementations, it's useful to think of it that way. So people usually think of convolutional codes as different from block codes. Okay, but in practice, when you restrict your block length, you'll always restrict your block length. It becomes a block code really. Okay, there's nothing wrong with that.
So, it depends on the present state of the system. Here we are.
So I'm going to start with all zero. I'm going to say I'm going to end at all zero. That's built. So that's understood.
Yeah. If you do that, then you get different outputs.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. You have to clear out your state after k bits. Once you do that, it comes out. Okay. So So from all zero state to all zero state, it becomes a linear block code. Okay, like he points out, if you don't clear out your state, then all kinds of things can happen. Okay, it will become very different. You can't say anything else. But if from all zero state, yeah, for every k, you will clear out. So once you do that, but the what you do for clearing out is not really message. You have to clock in three other zeros, which is not really message. It's just zero. So you can't count it as message. So that's why you get that extra hit and six. Okay. All right. So this is the example. So rate, though the rate is less than half, it's typical to say that this is a rate half encoder. Okay. So because for every bit that's going in, you're putting out two bits, and the design rate will become half if k becomes very large, right? If k becomes like 1000, 1000 by 2006 is very close to half. You don't have to worry too much about that. Okay. So it's usual to call this as a rate half convolutional encoder, 8 state rate half convolutional encoder. Okay, so that's how you talk about this encoder. So I can give you so many other pictures. Now you can imagine what are the various possibilities for an 8 state encoder. If I don't want any feedback connections, only feed forward connections, just a question of varying those connections, right? There are 8 possible connections. You can either keep any one of them on or off. So you have 2^8, which is 256 possibilities. So you can enumerate all the possible convolutional codes of a given number of states. It's possible feed forward. Okay, and we'll see later on, it's enough if you do feed forward. Okay, we may not see, I'll just maybe state the result saying feed forward is good enough. Okay. So one also talks about generator matrix. Okay, so what do you do with the generator matrix? It's all quite simple. There's really nothing more to say here. I'll say generator matrix is G of D. What do you think I'll do here? I'll just simply collect G0D and G1D and keep it here. Okay. And the logic behind why I call the generator matrix is V0D, V1D can be written as U of D times G0D, G1D. Okay. This is how this works. Okay, so this is for a rate half encoder. So now I can generalize this half. Okay, for every one input, I can produce 3 outputs, 4 outputs, 5 outputs, any number of outputs I want. Okay, so what will happen if, for instance, I do a rate 1 by m encoder? How many g's will I have? G0, g1 to g, m minus 1. How many v's will I have? V0, v1 to v, m minus 1. And I'll keep multiplying like this and I'll get it. It's also possible to do m by n convolutional codes. Okay, you can have multiple input streams, multiple output streams. We will not see that in this class. It's not enormously difficult, but it's just that they'll get a little bit confusing and we don't want to deal with that. So we'll only deal with rate 1 by m convolutional codes. And in fact, even turbo codes are typically constructed with only rate 1 by m codes. So you don't really need the rate m by n. There's some technique called puncturing which you can use to get the other rates. So we'll use only rate 1 by m in this class. Okay, so we'll stick to encoders. A general description for them will be given by g of d being equal to some g0 of d, g1d, so on till g m minus 1 of d. Okay. So I'll say all this is just feed forward. There's no feedback involved anywhere. It's only feed forward. Again, we'll restrict ourselves to feed forward. Okay. So maybe later on when we do turbo codes, I'll show you why you need feedback and all that. So there'll be some points where feedback will be needed. But so far, as far as convolutional codes are concerned, we'll restrict ourselves to feed forward for simplicity. Okay. Suppose I give you a G of D. Can you go back and draw the picture for the encoder? Does it fully specify the encoder? Sufficient? How will you know the memory? How will you know the number of D flip-flops you need? Yeah, the maximum degree of one of these G's should tell you, right? The maximum degree of one of these G's will give you the number of D's you need. And then you just put it out there, you will get the picture. Okay, going from here to the picture is easy. So it's enough if I specify this. Okay, so mostly only this will be specified when people describe a convolutional encoder. They'll only specify the coefficients of these G of D's. Okay, so once you have that, you can design your convolutional encoder. Okay, So there's one more way to visualize how your convolutional encoder is functioning, and that's crucial for the decoding. Okay, so that is the trellis representation. It's very, very crucial. And again, I'll do it for the example. You see, it's easy enough for the general case as well. Okay, of course, one way you know of visualizing a state machine is what? You might have seen this before, this state diagram, right? So you put the states in circle and then put the connections according to the input stroke output, and then you put the connections. Okay, but one thing that's missing in that state diagram is the time axis. Okay, so you don't have the time axis, right? You have to kind of keep track of time in your head. If you start with some state, you have to say, I'm going here. Time in your head is a little bit difficult sometimes, particularly for engineers. Anything in the head is difficult. So what we do is we put the time axis also explicitly in the diagram and make it a trellis representation. Okay, so instead of just having a state diagram which is same for all time, you put the states at different time as different entities and connect them up. You get what's called a trellis diagram, and that's particularly useful when you want to do decode. Okay, so that's the next thing we'll see. Trellis representation. Okay, so remember my V0 is, V0n is un plus S0 plus S2, am I right? And then Vn1 is un plus S0 plus S1 plus S2. Okay, this is the example, the same example as before. I'm sorry? First one is S1 plus S2. Okay, so this is my update equation. With this, I'll show you how to do the state diagram. Okay, so initially you're starting at the all zero state. Okay, so my at the initial starting time, I have the all zero state. Okay, so I'll put zero here. Okay, so I'll denote my state as a 3-bit number. Okay, so 0 to 7. Right, 0 is 0, 0, 0, 1 is what? 0, 0, 1. Okay, 2 is 0, 1, 0. Likewise, you can do 0 to 7. It's very easy. Okay, this is my state. Okay, now I can have two different inputs. My input can either be 0 or 1. My input is 0, what will happen? I'll go to the same state, and what will be my output? I'll get two outputs, 0, 0. Okay, so that's how, this is how I'll denote it. It's again a standard way in the state diagrams. I'll say my input is 0. Output is 0, 0, and then I go back to the same state. In a state diagram, typically what would you have done? You would have looped back, right? But I want to bring back the time axis explicitly in the states, so I'll push my state to the next time instant, which becomes the next circle on the right hand side. Okay, so it goes to the next. Okay, what if my input is 1? Sorry? 0, 0, 1 is the next state. So you remember, you don't have to compute the output to figure out the next state, right? Once you know the input, you can know the next state immediately. Now there is some confusion about how I'm going to write it. Okay, so I'm going to write my state as S0, S1, S2. This is how I'm going to write my state. Okay, this is a convention I'm choosing. You can also choose S2, S1, S0. It doesn't change anything. You can also choose S1, S2, S0 if you want. Okay, it doesn't change anything except that your head will go for a spin. Okay, just make one simple choice and stick to it. Okay, I'm going to choose S0, S1. S2. So my input is 1. What will be my next state? 100, which is 4. Okay, so I have to do 4. So maybe I put 1 here, 2 here, 3 here, maybe 4 will come here. I'm sorry? What happened? Okay. I'm doing okay, right? Did I make a mistake? 4 is correct. Okay, then I have to figure out the output. Okay, so output is going to be 1, and output is 1, 1 in this case, right? My initial state was 0, so we put input 1, I'll get output 1, 1. Okay, is that clear? Okay, use these update equations if you're getting confused. See, remember, this is the state after the transition. So when you compute the output, what state should you use? The original state that you were in. Don't use the new state. Okay, then you'll get what's called a race condition, right? So you don't do such things. Okay. So you do very simple things here. Okay, then now what do? You just keep repeating this process, you'll get the full trellis. Eventually the trellis will become complete, as in all the states will show up, and then you can just repeat the same thing over and over again. Okay, so do the next state, spend some time, don't look at the board, just keep doing it on your own and check if you've done everything correctly at the end. Okay. Okay, I hope you guys are doing a better diagram than what I'm doing here on the board. So I'm sorry. Yeah, I'm not going to put outputs. You have to put the outputs. Okay, so I think my diagrams are getting nasty. So I'm going to just stop at this point. Maybe then show you a picture. Maybe I made a... Did I do it correctly? Maybe I made a mistake somewhere. I think I made a mistake somewhere. So let's just go back. 6 it goes to 3, no? Yeah, so that's the mistake. And 2 comes to 5. You're right. See, it's very easy to make a mistake here. So I'll stop at this stage and then you can extend it. After that, you'll see 0 and 1 have the same behavior, right? There's no difference between 0 and 1 as far as what state it goes to is concerned. Okay, 2 it goes to 1 and 5, right? 4 it goes to 2 and 6. 6 it goes to 3 and 7. Okay, I have not put the outputs. You can put the output. And after a while, you don't even have to label the states. It's clear it's going from 0 to 7. And what will happen in the next time instant? It will get full and complete. Okay, so from 1 and 0 will have the same behavior as far as transitions are concerned. Okay, the last bit is actually getting out, no? So if two states differ in the last bit, it doesn't really matter. They'll behave the same way. The output will be different. Okay, the output will obviously be different, but the states they go to will be the same. Okay, so one can fill it out. Maybe I'll fill it out for this. And then what is the 0, 1, 1, 0? Okay. 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 So the outputs will be different. You can go through, complete the trellis. So this is how it works out. Okay. So it's common to identify each stage of the trellis. Okay. This is a stage. Okay. These are all stages. Right. So every stage corresponds to a time instant. Okay, so this is time 0, stage at time 0, this is stage at time 1, it's time 2, etc. Okay, so at time 0, you get an input which is U0 and you produce outputs which are V00 and V10. Okay, so that's how you label the axis U0 stroke V00 V10. Okay, time 1 your input will be U1 and output will be V0, 1 and V1, 1. Okay, but actually the trellis captures all possible inputs and all possible outputs at every stage. Okay, so up to k stages, it's actually the k minus 1, time k minus 1 you'll be getting actual messages. After that your input will become only 0. Okay, so that way you will go back to the all zero state. I'm going to show that. Okay, so from here on the stage will be complete and at stage k minus 1. Okay, so I need more space here. So let me just show how it works. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay, so you have 8 stages and say this is k minus 1 time instant. Okay, you would have gotten, let me just move this guy out somewhere here. Oops. There's no good place for this. Okay, so I'll move it here. Okay, it's not too bad. Okay, so the last thing you would have done was put in UK minus 1 and then you would have outputted U0K minus 1, V0K minus 1, V1, k minus 1. Okay. So after this, there is no more input. Okay. So what should your input be? 0. Okay. So input will be 0 in time k. Then how many inputs will you need? 3 other inputs. Okay. K, k plus 1 and k plus 2. You get a total of 3 kids. So when you see the input is only 0, the number of possible states will become 4 after time k. Okay, so input is only 0. So from 8 you'll go to what? You'll go to 0 from 1 and 0 and 1. You'll go to 2 from 2 and 3. You'll go to 4 from 4 and 5. Am I right? Or am I making a mistake? Starting with 0, right? So from 2 and 3 you'll go to 1. Okay, so that's where you'll go. Okay, so you'll go to 1. Then from 4 and 5 you will go to 2. Okay, so you will go to 2. Then from 6 and 7 you will go to 3. Because only 0 is allowed as the input, but the output can be non-zero, and that's very important. You can't throw away the output. The output is part of your code word, right? And then after that, time k plus 1, what will happen? One more 0. So 0 and 1 you will get. In fact, these two guys will go here. These two guys will go here, and then at the last time instant you will get back to state 0. Okay, this will be k plus 2. Okay, so this is a complete trellis representation for every possible code word that can come out of your convolutional code with k input message bits. Okay, so this is the trellis representation that people are talking about. Okay, and every code word is represented on this trellis. How will I find an arbitrary code word? Just follow the root of the message, you'll get code word. Okay, so one statement one can make on this trellis is every path on the trellis corresponds to a code word. Okay, so a valid path, you can't take all kinds of directions. Okay, so only some directions are allowed, right? So once you go to a particular state, you can only go to two other states, you can't go to all kinds of states. Okay, every valid path on the trellis corresponds to a code word. Okay, so you can imagine doing some kind of decoding on this trellis later on. Okay, so that's what we'll see in the next class. There's no class tomorrow, so we'll meet again next Wednesday and we'll continue from